Hey folks, got a video today about battery chargers. I know it's been a while since I've made some videos or even been online answering comments, but I've been busy at work and it's been interesting, challenging work, so I've been spending all my time doing that and not playing around on the internet. But I finally got home from about 3 weeks of work time, and I'm going to take some time off. Before that, a good friend and I were visiting, and he has a car that he hasn't been driving and going to get it cranked up and check it out. Well, we couldn't find a battery charger, and he's just moved, and you know, when you move all your stuff, there's always some things that don't make it. So we searched, and his battery charger is missing. After that, we went to all the stores that we could go to within reason. We went to the Advance, AutoZone, O'Reilly, Walmart, and even Harbor Freight. And we found chargers, but we couldn't find anything that was really suitable. But the problem with all the newer stuff is the housings are plastic, and it looks like it would easily crack if you bumped it or dropped it just a little bit. And the biggest problem, everything now is gimmicky. They all have some kind of dumb gimmick that is not necessary and is going to make the charger have a short life. And it's also going to make it where when something does go wrong, you'll never be able to get parts and you'll never be able to fix it. So I told my friend I was going to look at some for an old charger to fix up. And what you see here are three that I found going to antique shops and flea markets while I was driving around for my work. So what I'm going to do is check these out, see if they're savable, and I'm pretty sure, probably all of them are, but I'm pretty sure at least one, and I'll get my buddy a good charger fixed up. Probably this is the one that's in the best shape. Everything appears good condition on it. It's probably the newest of them all, of these three. Sears brand. Looks like it's just usable as it is. I don't see any country of origin on it, but looking at the switch and some of the writing on it on the bottom here, and just the way that label is made, it looks like it's probably Chinese. But it's still an all-metal case, and there's no gimmicks. It's all just a mechanical switch. So this one is pretty good starting point, but it's only 6 amp, so pretty small. And the cable, or the power cord, looks to be in fair condition. It still has fairly flexible insulation on the charging cable. That would have to be redone. That clamp seemed pretty functional. So I don't know, this was at a flea market, and I don't know what the story is on it, but it was $5, so hey, can't go wrong with that. So I'll check the next one. All right, next we have a Schumacher 10 amp automatic charger. It looks to be in dirty, but not too bad condition. Dual voltage, the legend plate, what have you, is still in pretty good shape. Made in USA. Only thing about this one that I'm not too sure about, it has a bit of a smell to it. It smells kind of like a burned transformer. And if the transformer's bad, there's really no hope for it. Unless I can find another charger that's crushed or something. That I don't like. Earth pin is gone, so this one, the power cord is totally hopeless. And then somebody has replaced the clips with these tiny ones. And they're just not in good shape. Look how well the jaws line up. So this one is 10 amp. That's the highest current one I was able to get, so I hope that one I can fix. But that one will require a really thorough inspection before I make a decision on it. And finally, last but not least, is this one. Schumacher Electromite. This was put there by someone to protect the instrument. I'm actually glad they did that, because you can see there's a custom printed Schumacher background on that amp meter, which You know, I wouldn't be able to find anything like that. If I were to get another meter, it would be just plain. So the fact that they cared enough to cover that up after the original meter face got knocked off says a lot. So I would have to get another little plastic cover for that, which I've been trying to find for my automatic Schumacher and haven't yet. So maybe I'll have to make one. They said, and by the way, I paid $1 for this. They said it was from an estate sale that they had bought a lot of stuff from. And doesn't look to have had a lot of heavy use. I mean, other than the barn dust and what have you on it, clips are still good. Cable condition is good, and even nobody's cut the earth pin off. So this one's also pretty cool. Of course, made in USA. Don't see any kind of a date code on it. I know mine, I think, has a 1978 date code. It's almost identical to that, but automatic. So we'll open them up and do some electrical checks. This one's definitely barn fresh. Everything about it makes me think of an old dusty barn. All the crud in it. But it may be all corroded inside and not be easy to fix, but we'll see. Definitely going to have to paint this one if it's going to be fixed up. Take that one out. That would appear to be all the fasteners. Hopefully I'm staying in frame there. I'm not really watching that close. Trying to slide this out without doing any damage. Oh, there we go. Definitely barn fresh. So, okay, I'm going to cut off the video and I'm going to disconnect this meter so I don't lay it down on the face and damage that meter, since that's one of the things that makes this one pretty neat, and I'll be right back. Well, I found an interesting surprise that I didn't see earlier when the case was all connected. I haven't found a date on this anywhere, but I think it is really, really old, because you see these parts back here? Those are selenium rectifiers. That's what they used before they had regular, you know, diodes, that, like we're all familiar with. That's more or less the predecessor to a diode. And that uses two of those in the push-pull configuration with the transformer to convert the AC to DC. And from what I gather reading and watching videos about this old equipment, those rectifiers tend to fail, and if this doesn't work, that's probably why. Another interesting thing, try to zoom in on it here. This little glass tube, that is a circuit breaker. So if you overload it, that'll protect it from burning out. The new ones, that's all going to be a little plastic module instead of that glass tube. You can see the contacts there inside it. Better view of the rectifiers. So what I'm going to do is, I don't have a battery in here handy at the moment. I'm going to hook up a handheld floodlight to it and see if it will light up that floodlight. But first, before I plug it in, I'm going to check to make sure there's not any dead shorts. So I've got the meter set for resistance mode. I don't know if you can see the screen there. And I'm going to connect one of the meter leads to ground on the unit, like so. And then I'm going to connect the other one to the end of the cord. So this through there, touching both of the power pins, the hot and the neutral. I'm going to touch it to the transformer. Get no continuity means the transformer is not earth faulted. Then I'm going to touch it to the charger leads. Make sure it's not a short between the input and output side, and that's good. There's no short. And then if I check from one side here to the other, I got a complete circuit through the transformer primary. So it looks like it's okay. And then the earth pin or ground pin, connect from that. And I should see continuity to the body of the charger. And the reason it's not good is because this ground wire from the other end of the cord broke off. So that's something I'll have to fix before I consider this ready to put to use. But right now I've got it sitting on cardboard, so it's isolated. I'm not going to worry about it, and I just want to see if it's going to work. And I won't touch it while it's powered on. Okay, so what I've got here, over here, kind of almost off screen, I've got the clamp leads of the meter, or of the charger, connected to this old Q-beam light. And I have the switch bypassed in 12 volt mode, current meter hooked up, and voltmeter. And now it's starting to rain, so you won't be able to hear much. Let me go plug it in. Well, it looks like it's working. Voltage is a little low. That may be because of the rectifier, so I'll have to come back and check that. Well, my booster pack was fully charged, so I've got the Q-beam light turned on to use up some of the charge on the battery. And I want to get that voltage a little bit lower. I'm going to get it down to, let me check the open circuit voltage with the light off. See, that battery's still got a pretty full charge. Oh, my Q-beam went out. Yep, it's not connected. So as soon as it's depleted down a little more, I'll turn on the charger and see what kind of current. With the battery pulled down and then that load on the system, that charger should be, was rated at 6 amps, so that should make it put out about its rated amps, about 6. I'll give it another few minutes to discharge, and then I'll come back and we'll turn the charger on and see what happens. Well, in between rain showers, I'm going to try to explain. The selenium rectifier was taken, the place was taken by this. Now, this was rated a 6 amp charger with that big thing in it. This is a 25 amp diode bridge. And this has got 4 diodes in it, and that's only 2 selenium rectifiers. So this can do take the place of that, and it could even do more, but in this case it will exactly take the place of that. So I'm going to turn on the charger power and see how much current we're going to put back into that battery. Looks like about 3.5 amps according to that little meter. Now I'm going to change for the diode bridge. See what kind of an improvement it makes, if any. Okay, so there's the diode bridge down there connected in place of the selenium rectifier. Fixing to go plug it in again. Look at that. That is right at 6 amps, exactly what it's rated for. So, looks like all the information I found online was right. Those rectifiers do deteriorate with age. Powered it back off. I'll see what I can find as far as a mounting location for that. Well, I got the selenium rectifier assembly out. It had the two individual rectifiers and I guess a heat sink plate, aluminum plate, and that was your positive, or excuse me, your negative side of the output went to the charger. And of course it had to be isolated with this this piece of material behind it. This is a, I don't know technically if it's a semiconductor or not, but it's an early solid state device. And the junction that would allow current to flow only one way was just where this little piece was pressed against this surface. This side's plain. I'm guessing that coating on there is a selenium. But you see some arc damage right there where it's got some little pits arced in it? And some damage on that too. And all this, the spacer and this stuff here kept that little spring cup thing under some tension. So what I'm going to use is this diode bridge. And this part, this was part of an old TV that I scrapped out a long time ago. Mount that in there like so. And I'm going to put it in the charger back here, bolted to where one of the mounting bolts for the selenium rectifier plate went. And the same wiring will plug directly onto it, and it should be good to go. So I'll put that together and see what we get. Okay, light's been on for 10 or 15 minutes. Got the rectifier mounted, put some thermal paste behind it, a little heat sink. So I'm going to go plug it in and see what kind of current we get charging into that battery. All right. A little more than 6 amps, which that's what you'd expect because we got that light on there for load. Didn't turn it off. Right where it should be. I have the ground wire fixed, so I'm not afraid to touch it now. That selenium rectifier got real hot real fast. This one I can't feel any heat. Not even right on it. Once again, that's a 25 amp diode bridge with only 6 amps, so definitely overkill, but something I had here. Cost me nothing. Got that going. Well, I cleaned everything and I gave it a coat of clear varnish to help seal it from any future moisture getting in it, and just make it a little more durable. So now do a little restoration work on the outside part and put her back together. Okay, while the paint's drying on that the old Schumacher 6 amp, I'm going to tear down this one, the Sears 6 amp. I really don't expect anything to be wrong with this one. I think it's probably working condition. But I've been really wrong in the past about things that looked really good. And then when I tried to use it or took it down and inspected it, it was a basket case. So that, and what makes me wonder about this one, it's like it's in too good of a shape. So why would they sell it? Why would they sell it at a flea market? So, doesn't look like it's visibly charred on the transformer. Although, actually, it does look a little darker than it should be. So let me get the meter out and make some electrical checks. And compare this with the old one. This is its circuit breaker, plastic body there with a little metal cover. The rectifier uses two discrete diodes. I don't know if you can see them or not. They're right down in there, the two. Oh, there's the problem. See, that diode's broken in half. Right there. This one's still in place. But the fact that that diode's broken in half, that makes me think that somebody probably connected it up backwards to a battery or something else like that happened. So maybe the transformer's no good. If that's the case, oh well, you know, it was only $5. I'll just keep the housing and the meter and build another charger in it later or something. But you know, gotta take chances in order to potentially move forward. But I haven't given up on it yet. Okay, I took the rivets out, took the transformer out of this charger, make it easier to look at or to see. And right there, you can see the now two-piece diode. And this discoloration here is what worries me. But even more so, these are your two charge rate inputs to the primary winding. This is the common. And where that goes in, it looks like there's a thermal fuse deep inside the transformer. And I bet that thermal fuse is blown. And it's a one-shot fuse. So if it's blown, I would have to replace the thermal fuse. And in the case of this, I don't think I'd be able to get to it. So if I take a resistance measurement, see, I get nothing. It's open. If I go between these two windings, I've got continuity. But this is the common point. So unless I can somehow manage to wiggle that thermal fuse out of there, this transformer will not be usable. And if you look where this wire here goes up into the winding, there's a blue cone-shaped piece that it's going into. That's the end of the thermal fuse. And unless I can get that out of there without damaging the transformer, it won't be savable. So I'll do what I can. Well, I decided I would deconstruct the transformer and get a better look at that thermal fuse. That wire coming out of that blue thing, that's the thermal fuse right there. And on old school transformers, it would have two of these tabs with one of them going to the winding and then the thermal fuse bridging the two. So if it failed, you could put another one on the outside to restore it. But this, I don't know. That's just really sorry design. Really sorry. Well, in an act of desperation, I took the Dremel and I ground away some of the plastic bobbin around the back of that thermal fuse. And I was able to get to the other side of it where it's connected to the winding. So let's see if the winding itself has any continuity. So this time I'm going to go from one of the input wires, and this is to the thermal fuse original output terminal, nothing. If I touch it to that part of the thermal fuse, I got something. So I'm going to see if I can make a highly ill-advised temporary repair and see if that transformer will work or not, just for the hell of it. Okay, I've installed a little single strand of wire, bypassed that internal thermal fuse, and the reason I say this is ill-advised, that cut I made in there, that's going to leave that really close to shorting, being an earth fault, so I'm going to have to figure out if it can be done, and if so, how, to make that safely insulated. And then if I think it can be done safely, I'll be able to test it. Well, I figured out a way to seal it up. I put some resin in there and then to mechanically fill in the gap. Then I salvaged some of this this insulation sheet from the old selenium rectifier on the other charger and cut that piece to go in there. So I feel pretty confident that is not going to go to earth. And of course, I'll have a mega tester where I can put high voltage on that and verify it is not faulted before I energize it. And we'll get to see that test before long, I hope. So just put this back together. The bobbin just sits on the core like so. A little silicone on there I might need to clean off first, making it tight. I don't want to put too much stress on it. I don't think the silicone is any kind of special magnetic silicone or what have you. I think it was probably just put there to keep something from vibrating and humming. So I put this back together. I might squirt something down in there like that to give it some support. Now maybe it'll go back together without having to put a lot of pressure on it. Yeah, like that. And then there's a wedge that goes in here. and I put it on this side so my modified area has the wooden wedge and the insulating paper to hold it apart. And now this was a welded transformer, so I'll have to clamp it in the vise over there and clamp it back together and tack it just like it was. But before that, I'm going to make sure I haven't dislodged anything. Make sure I've still got continuity. Okay. Oh, I'm touching it now. No fault there. Gather those both together. So far, so good. I'm not going to try to video the welding because I think that would damage my camera. But I've got a tack weld across there and weld the core back together. And to protect the winding from any hot sparks, I've put wet paper towels and I've packed it really tight. So there should be no way sparks can get on the winding. And there can't be a gap. So I've got the vise under a lot of pressure. And then this clamp is keeping everything in line. So it's all bound back together in the original position. And I'm going to turn off the camera and weld it. Okay, that's what the result looks like. You see the little dust there, but not no sparks on the winding. Same on that side. Take it out, clean it up, take a closer look at it. Okay, this is an insulation resistance checker. And what it will actually do, this lead, I will set the transformer on it for a ground reference. Then the red lead, when I set this, it's on 1,000 volts. So when I put it on test mode, there's 1,051 volts on that wire. So when I touch this to this terminal, see the meter still shows it's open circuit, 2.2 gigaohms. So we do not have an insulation fault. Oh, no insulation fault. I'll touch it there. See, the meter's working. I don't know if you can see that little spark it makes. It's a 1,000 volt charge coming from that. And that winding and its insulation is holding 1,000 volts without leakage when that's on there. So when I put our 120 volt mains voltage on there, it's certainly not going to arc over. So we got that test out of the way. Now I'm going to hook it up and put power on the primary and see if it is going to work or if it's got an internal shorted winding. Give me a minute to hook that up. Okay, I know I got a lot of stuff going on here at once, but this meter is set up for just voltage. This is measuring current. So when I plug in this cord over here, that transformer will be energized and we'll see what happens. We've got a 0.5 amp flowing, which seems kind of high, but transformers use reactive power. Let's see what kind of load or voltage output we got here. 13.1 on that side. Same on that side. We should get about 24, 26 that way. So, yeah. Transformer appears to be working. Just unplugged it. It's hard to tell. This core is still warm from the welding, but the winding doesn't seem any warmer. Feels pretty stable. Only the true test will be to hook the rest of the charger up and see if it'll actually work or if the transformer gets hot now. Well, there's the original diodes. I wonder what the inside of one looks like. But we've got another diode bridge. This one doesn't have a hole, so I'll have to somehow clamp it on there for cooling, because this is what the heat dissipates to. Well, got her back together. Got the rectifier bridge put on there, put some thermal compound and a little clamp. Got the heat sink plate in place, everything back together. One thing I added, you see here, put an external fuse holder since the transformer doesn't have that internal thermal fuse anymore. That is a 2 amp time delay fuse, slow blow fuse. So if the transformer starts to fail and it just gets turn to turn shorts more and more and more, before it'll catch on fire or just create a dead short, that fuse will blow, prevent it from being a safety issue. If the thermal fuse is mounted on the outside of the winding, it's better, because then you can change it and get your transformer fixed if something goes wrong. But this design was stupid. No way to get to it. So I was able to bypass it and put that external fuse. So I'm going to check it out, see what happens. Got this meter hooked up to measure the current. This is the primary current going into the transformer on the 120 volt side. Then of course the charger itself has a meter on it there where you can see. We've got the spotlight hooked up to lower the battery charge down, so there'll be some load on the charger. Get it plugged in here. Put it on 6 amp mode. Turn off the spotlight, let it charge the battery back up. So with the battery not fully charged, pulling about a little over 6 amps on the 6 amp setting, right at 2 on the 2 amp setting. .1 input there and .4 on 2 amp mode. Now with that transformer, I know it got hot, so only way to know if it's going to really live or not is just to leave it on. And if it stays on and doesn't pop the fuse, then I know it's good. So we'll get the cover back on it, get that one back together. That's 2 out of 3 so far. One last one to check today. Well, on to the last one. First, I'm going to deconstruct this, and we'll see what kind of wizardry has been done inside here to extend this cord. So I don't know what we're going to see, but I guarantee you it's not going to be pretty. Yep, already found some shittiness. Look how strong that was. Alright. That looks like a cut-off spade terminal connecting the earth lead together. And another one there. Man, what quality craftsmanship. And then of course, look at that. So yeah, that part's garbage, and this is too short, so I'll end up having to change the cord on this one, but that's not a big deal. Go ahead and proceed with the teardown. See what internal condition we have here. This one is so hard to tell visually, because I thought that little red charger was going to be just have nothing wrong with it, and it turned out having the most so far. Transformer, internal fuse, and the rectifier busted. And then the cruddiest one, the oldest, cruddiest one, just needed the rectifier replaced. And it was working, just not strong. All right, boy, this is dirty. Here's a bee's nest, or a mud wasp nest. Put that away. Pretty good sized transformer. You can see this one has actual diodes in there, like an alternator. You can take them out, easily change them if necessary. So first of all, this will just be a cleaning job, and then come back and see if it's going to work. Also here in the middle, that device, that is an SCR of some type used for its automatic function. So this seems to be a really sturdy made unit. And it's got its external circuit breaker right there. Get into it a little further and then I'll come back. All right, on this 10 amp automatic, had a crazy problem. This little circuit board, it was riveted to this clip. And it turns out that rivet had to make an electrical connection from the heat sink to the board. Without that connection, it doesn't work. And it got corroded, so I made this little wire, new wire. It goes behind there, soldered to the board, and bolted on right there. And everything seems to be working. I got everything hooked up. I got the light, searchlight on to load the battery down. 11.6 volts. Get it plugged in here. There it goes. It's about 6 or 7 amps. Voltages should be going up slowly but surely. Only thing I haven't checked yet is the regulation voltage where it cuts off, because there's an adjustment right there. And this thing, somebody had had it apart before and probably monkeyed with that. But I think probably for tonight, that's going to be it. I've got all three of these chargers working. Ironically, the one that appeared to be the worst at first, the old, really old one, had virtually nothing wrong with it other than deterioration from age on the selenium rectifier. This one had some issues, and the littlest one, the best looking one, had the worst issue. So you just never know what you're going to get. Now, I'll make a part two video where I'm putting them back together and cleaned up, so this was just a technical aspect of it. I will catch you guys later. The automatic charger is working. Got it on the booster pack, charging it back up. Up to 13.6 volts. This one, I'm going to unplug the AC power. I don't have a permanent AC cord yet. The thermal fuse that I had to change on the other little transformer, this transformer has a thermal fuse also. And I'm going to see how good this macro zoom is going to work. But gotta get something to point with. Right in this hole, right there, it's like a little gray plastic hole with a wire going in it on that end. And on this end over here is the other end of that. So, right there. And that is the end of the thermal fuse. You see, if I touch it and push on it there, on that end, it'll move on that end. And if the thermal fuse were to blow, it can be desoldered right here from the winding wire. And then you can pull the thermal fuse out and change it, because that's just a hollow cardboard sleeve through the transformer. So this is the original design where that fuse would save the transformer and you could change it. The one on the Sears charger, really a bad idea. I don't understand why, but it is what it is. This one I'm not going to put the cover on yet, because I got to change the cord, and the cord grommet goes in there. So, oh, and also this clip started smoking because of the way they crimped it and didn't solder it. So new AC cord and new clamps, and this will be good to go. Well, two chargers here, ready to go. This one I was worried about the transformer because of it looked a little discolored and the thermal fuse was bad, but it's been on for probably 4 hours now and it's not warm. doesn't smell, everything's working. This really old one, the one that I took the selenium rectifier out of, it was so rusted I had to paint it, and I had that hammer tone paint that I think looks pretty good on there. And I want to find a cover for that meter because I know it'll be damaged. And the 6 and 12 volt switch works. So yeah, those two are good. And on this one, original clips. And the cord and the plug is original too. I got these for flea markets and old junk shops like that. And sometimes you do good and sometimes you do bad. In this case, I think I did okay. I spent a lot of time on that one though. But hey, it's all for fun.